I have been using a high concentration of dextrose solution and a low dose of dexamethasone palmitate. What? I have felt that there were many suspicious eyes and questions. The corticosteroids can both inhibit and stimulate bone cell proliferation and differentiation. What kind of treatment do you prefer for the painful rotator cuff tear? Would you consider an ultrasound intervention? I have two options. The first is the direct targeting the tendon pathology. The second option is the indirect approach to the tendon pathology, such as subacromial bursal and intra-articular injections. What is the rationale of ultrasound-guided injection for the rotator cuff tear? When I explain to the patients, I do not promise that it will heal the torn tendon. I usually start from the natural rule. Everything alive will be fade out and eventually disappear. There is no exception. Rotator cuff degeneration and tear are inevitable and comes to everyone, and the chances increase by the aging process. But fortunately, many tears remain silent stage or bearable condition. It shows that the prevalence of partial or full secondary tears increased markedly after 50 years of age and was 80% of asymptomatic subjects over 80 years of age. Do you think the asymptomatic rotator cuff tears could remain silent forever? Asymptomatic patients could be symptomatic over the years. I think more people have more symptomatic when the pathology enlarges. Vice versa, symptomatic rotator cuff tear could be asymptomatic by conservative treatment. How about surgery for the rotator cuff tear? Is it significantly changed the difference of natural course? In a meta-analysis study, the difference between surgery and conservative treatment was statistically significant in a one-year follow-up, but below the level of minimal clinically significant difference. That is why when you consider surgery, we should analyze the multiple factors. It is the consensus of surgical indication of rotator cuff tear. Group of patients having larger than 1 cm symptomatic full thickness cuff tear in young patients is primary indication. Initial non-operative care should be considered in older patients with chronic tears. Older patients have more multiple and severe diseases than younger ones. Elderly patients have a high chance of multiple degenerative problems. The rotator cuff tear could be the tip of the iceberg for them. If we decide on an operation on each disease, they have to spend their whole time and money to undergo surgery. Let me go back to clinical practice. I have been using a high concentration of dextrose solution and a low dose of dexamethasone palmitate. What? I have felt that there were many suspicious eyes and questions. The first question is why I use a high concentration of dextrose instead of 10 to 15% dilution. My logic is simple. Be realistic. I have a question first for you. Do you think this torn tendon can regrow to attach to the footprint of the supraspinous tendon by regenerative treatment? There are several human studies on ligament or tendon proliferation. For example, the dextrose injection in lateral epicondylitis showed clinical improvement. In the rotator cuff tendinosis, the dextrose showed clinical improvement but did not change the morphology. Pain resolution was reported faster with dextrose than placebo treatment. Researchers hypothesized that the TRPV1 receptors were downregulated or receptors were directly affected. I will introduce another study. It is their conclusion. Injection into normal tendon, ligament, or peritendon causes tendon ligament thickening or peritendinous proliferation. However, there is no demonstrable healing process or tissue regeneration in the injured ligament or tendon. Several reports use hypotonic dextrose in pain-relieving interventions. Some doctors underwent disc space injection of 50% dextrose. They hypothesized that the rapid onset of pain relief is attributable to chemoneuromodulation of adjacent nociceptors caused by high osmolality. The second question is why I use steroids in prolotherapy. Does the steroid inhibit the regenerative process? As I commented before, I do not use dextrose for tissue proliferation, but I'm relieving pain by different unknown mechanism. Furthermore, I think a high concentration of dextrose is better than low concentration. That is the reason I use a high concentration of dextrose. So my steroids did not conflict with the intention of dextrose injection. The tendon rupture is the most severe complication, but I have found one common clue producing the complications. Would you please pay attention to this number? They inject 40 mg of triamcinolone. My second philosophy is cost effectiveness and better safe than sorry. Do not harm the tendon. Most anti-steroid doctors blame steroids, but they do not mention high concentration of particulate steroids. I found several interesting articles about dexamethasone. It has been used for a long time in the laboratory and used for different purposes. The corticosteroid can both inhibit and stimulate bone cell proliferation and differentiation. The data shows that the concentration and timing of dexamethasone exposure may be critical factors in determining either proliferation or inhibition. The most robust osteoblastic differentiation was observed when 100 nanomole dexamethasone was present for the first week. I published this paper recently. I compared pure prolotherapy and whole blood injection group with minimal dose of corticosteroid group. I want to say that including a minimal dose of corticosteroid in tennis elbow can reduce pain and decrease dropout rate. Furthermore, it did not worsen the long-term prognosis compared to pure prolotherapy. Now, do you understand why I use a high concentration of dextrose solution and a low dose of dexamethasone palmitate? Actually, I always worry about secondary infections, not the side effect of low dose of steroids. Let the patient supine with the surgical draping. I'll go for the subacromial bursal injection first. Would you please watch the patient's arm and hand? Put the arm side of the body and palm down. I'll scan the rotator cuff and observe the morphology and echotexture with you. There is a tendinosis and intrasubstance tear in the supraspinatus tendon. The intrasubstance tear connects to the articular surface tear. I let the arm externally rotate and mild abduction. There is severe wear and tear of subscapularis tendon. I'll go for the subacromial bursal injection. After putting the ultrasound probe to picture the supraspinatus tendon and footprint, I'll puncture the skin at the inferior lateral side of subdeltoid bursa toward the upper and medial aspect. In If there is no distension of subdeltoid bursal space while you push the pump smoothly, you did nicely put the needle in the correct space. I will slide the ultrasound probe side to side. I can watch fluid accumulation in the subacromial bursal space correctly. Next, I'll go for the intra-articular injection via anterior cuff interval. I'll let the arm externally rotate to open wide the anterior space. If you want to study more details, please review this video. I'll handle the syringe and approach from the inferior lateral side to upper medial aspect. Make sure not to harm the biceps tendon. It is difficult for the beginner to watch the subscapular tendon, bicep tendon, and needle simultaneously. So, put one structure on your memory while you are doing a perpendicular scan to that structure, and then move on to another structure. And place it all together to make a spatial orientation in your brain. While your needle is moving, focus on the needle pathway and biceps tendon. Well done! Thank you for watching. See you in the following videos.